So this is the presentation on intersemiotic translation. Okay, to begin with, let's have address the question. What is translation? I've used a quotation from Roman Jakobson, saying that a translation is an interpretation of verbal signs by means of some other language. That is translation. My next question is that all? Are there other possibilities? According to this definition, translation involves verbal signs or written language of the verbal signs. So what we speak and what we write. That's what a typical definition of translation is all about. There is more. Apart from verbal signs and transformation of verbal signs of one language into the verbal signs of another language, there are other types of translation too. The same person, Roman Jakobson, listed three types. One, interlingual, for example, between Chinese and English, or English and French, or between Chinese and French. There is also intralingual. For example, you paraphrase an English sentence with another English sentence. We'll ignore it in this course. But there is also a third type of translation called intersemiotic translation. It is defined as an interpretation of verbal signs by means of signs of non-verbal sign systems. That's also Roman Jakobson's definition. It's saying that the written language, or the vernacular language, or the verbal language of one language can be translated into other systems of signs in another language. So it's not translating written Chinese into written English anymore. It's not translating that certificate from English into a certificate in Chinese anymore. It's reworking, it's rewriting, it's representing the same signs with other signs, with other systems of signs, such as multimedia, such as audiovisual, such as other media. I'm quoting another scholar and myself too, saying that intersemiotic translation has been overlooked. A lot of people have done a lot of translations. A lot of people have studied in interlingual translations. A lot of people have published writings on interlingual translations. But very few people have paid attention to intersemiotic translation. That's why I say it's overlooked. In one of my forthcoming articles, I'm arguing intersemiotic translation is absent in translation, tertiary translation programs, especially with regard to Chinese-English translation and interpreting. So I'm proud to say this is the only course in the world that deals with intersemiotic translation. So I feel that I'm privileged to teach a course that incorporates intersemiotic translation. And you should be proud, because this is the only place where you can discuss, you can deal with intersemiotic translation too. Now, what is semiotic? Next question, what is semiotic? Semiotics is a discipline of study. It's a discipline of science. that studies how signs work. Another, a synonym of semiotics is seminology or sign studies. Let me use this. Semiotics is another word for seminology. Seminology. It's not even recognized by word. In other words, it's a study of signs. Did I say to the class that only 15% of the messages or information we communicate is conveyed by words or by languages? Another 85% of the information or messages is conveyed by other media, by body language, by multimedia, by digital means. So semiotics is a study of signs, S-I-G-N, and intersemiotic study. Intersemiotic translation involves written language in one language and other sign systems in other languages. I'll give you examples now. Why intersemiotics? Why semiotics? Why signs? These are two claims I'm making. One, claim number one, the world is moving to digitalization, animation, and multimedia. Claim number two, the world is moving to picture language. The world is moving towards picture and language as the media we use to communicate. If you use WeChat, if you use QQ, if you use one of those modern gadgets or applications, you'll be familiar with this. You see all these signs. And a lot of people say a picture says more than 1,000 words or 10,000 words. That's true. But if anybody is doing critical review, you can deal with this. You can provide references and you can discuss this move towards pictures and language. I'll tell you, this is how I communicate with my friends. This is how I communicate, or people in my generation communicate, even though we're using WeChat, or even though we're using modern gadgets or applications. People my generation communicate this way. We write, we are very wordy, and we are linear. From left to right, from top to down, we are hierarchical and linear, and we read and write. And I'll show you how people communicate, also in my groups, These are how people communicate. In first picture, someone as old as me says, let's discuss tennis. And someone says, yes, we should discuss tennis. And then someone gives hongbao, red packet. And then the next person doesn't write, read and write anymore. He sends an emoticon or something? Or a picture, a sign, an icon. 谢主隆恩. And the next person says, 谢谢老板. Next person says, 我抢到一笔巨款. And this two girls says, 那个发红包的人好帅啊. And this doesn't say anything, just give a smiling face. And this, 你是这个, thumbs up. And then more, it's animated. I cannot show the animation here. In the real chat, it's the thumb can move. And then someone else gives a thumbs up. So this is how people communicate anymore nowadays. That shows why intersemiotic translation is important now. And people communicate through language and through pictures, graphs, emojis. 所以这就是所谓的图文并茂了。 I'll give more examples to demonstrate and to also define intersemiotic translation. These are some of the examples. Four examples. I'll see if we have the time. If we have time, we'll show all of them. If we don't, we'll show some of them. Okay, by doing this, we're also reviewing some student content from previous 4 years. This is a student content made by maybe it's by students known to some of your class.
In a cold winter's night, inside a dark wood shield in the town of Yiwu, a young translator worked under the dim candlelight, through the cold and the hunger, forgetting all sense of time. His name is Chen Wangdao. Chen Wangdao was one of the most influential Chinese scholar, educator, and translator. One of his most well-known translation work which shaped the nation was the Communist Manifesto. Chen dedicated 4 months in 1920 to translate the piece that later became the blueprint for communism to dominate China. In the woodshed, he gave his full attention to the work that he forgot about the time. Chen studied law on board in Japan at Chuo University. After his return to China, he began to actively participate in the promotion of communism. He served as the president of Fudan University over 2 decades. Influences from his work as a translator, an educator, and journalist remains present today. Chen's dedication of his work was widely spread due to the much-told story of Ink and Sugar, where Chen was so concentrated on his work while translating the Communist Manifesto that he dipped the zhongzi in ink instead of sugar.
So that's made by students from last year, from last session. Now, watch this one too. This is promoted by CCTV, one of the few programs I give credit to by CCTV.
名字是人类了解事物的首要途径之一。我们每天都会在网络上看到许多寻找走失老人的寻人启事。他们中有很多人和我的妈妈一样，忘了自己的家在哪儿，因为他们都得了同一种病。而他们即将失去的不仅仅是回家的路。美国总统里根失去了引以为豪的演讲能力。诺贝尔奖获得者华裔物理学家高锟光纤之父不见了他的发明和所有研究成果。英国首相铁娘子撒切尔夫人丧失了他的智慧和自信。这个病叫做阿尔茨海默病，它还有一个广为人知的名字，老年痴呆症。中国目前有近1000万确诊的阿尔茨海默病患者，约占全世界的1/4。阿尔茨海默病的发病率会随着年龄递增，并且只能通过药物缓解大脑萎缩，目前还没有治愈的方法。当他记不起我结婚那天发生了什么的时候，我以为他上了年纪记性不好。当他拿起电话一遍又一遍地输入着号码，却怎么也想不起来要打给谁的时候，我以为他老糊涂了。当他买回来了各种假的购物卡、劣质保健品的时候，我以为他爱贪小便宜。我的妈妈找回来了， 但是他的记忆没有回来。医生说，妈妈患上了老年痴呆症。从此，痴呆这个词不停地出现在妈妈的生活中，出现在他人的目光中。老年痴呆和痴呆没有任何关系。我的妈妈和其他患者一样没有痴呆，他们只是患上了一种再普通不过的病，他们都变成了孩子。我的妈妈没有痴呆，她只是忘记了那些故事，我可以一遍一遍地讲给她听。我的妈妈没有痴呆，她只是忘了如何吃饭，我可以一口一口地喂给她吃。我的妈妈没有痴呆，她只是忘记了如何说话，我可以一遍一遍地教给她说。你还记得吗？我们小的时候，妈妈也是这样照顾我们的。名字是人类了解事物的首要途径之一，如果起点就是错的，终点往往也是错的。我不希望我的父母被人误解，被人歧视。你呢？如果你希望改变这一切，请用你的行动，用你的智慧为他们证明。你的每一次转发，每一次传播，都会给他们带来一缕阳光。用你的行动，要求所有人改变这一歧视性的称谓，消除歧视，从证明开始。也许他再也无法想起我的婚礉，不能记得我高考那天紧张的神情，不能想起我儿时因为踢球摔倒痛苦的哭声，甚至最终将我忘记。当你失去了所有的记忆，没关系，因为他一直在我心里。
There'll be two more examples to show. One involves 十三五， one involves 四个全面。But before we show them, I would like to invite people to consider some ethical questions too. Of the four, which would you rather not be involved with? Why? What's the basic rule of thumb when you make decisions?Okay, let's watch a few more. Two more.
Hey, have you guys heard what's going on in China?
President Xi Jinping's new style?
Yes, and there's more.
The Shi San Wu.
The what?
China's 13th five-year plan. Yeah, the Shi San Wu.
Oh.
Huge.
Like China huge?
Yeah, China huge.
Oh, that's really big.
If you want to know what China's gonna do, let's pay attention to the Shisanu. The Shisanu, the Shisanu.
The Shisanu what?
The Shisanu.
But who makes all the plans?
There's government ministers and think tank minds and party leadership contributing fines. There's doctors, bankers, and farmers too. And even engineers who deal with poo.
Ew, did I hear that right?
Yeah, it's true.What?
But how do they make all the plans?
First there's research views collected, then discussion and views projected. Reports get written and passed around.
Then there's, well, there's actually more research and more discussion and more research and more discussion. Like, at every level.
over and over, like through hundreds of rounds. It's...
Okay, we got it. Hundreds of rounds.
Oh my god.
Crazy, right?
Okay, one, two, three.
If you wanna know what China's gonna do, let's pay attention to the Shisanu. The Shisanu, the Shisanu.
The Shisan what?
The Shisanu.
But it's not over yet. When the plan comes out, the work's not done. In fact, it's really just begun. Because every province, county, city, too, have got to figure out what they're gonna do.
Whoa.
That's a lot to do.
I know.
Hey, what's it called again?
The Shisanu. If you wanna know what China's gonna do, let's pay attention to the Shisanu. The Shisanu, the Shisanu.
Then the plans keep getting even better. As the plan goes down from high to low, the government's experience continues to grow. They have to work hard and deliberate, because a billion lives are all at stake.
Like every job, Qian, Sun, Li, Zhou, Wu, Zheng, Wang, Feng, Qian, Chu, Wei, Jiang, Shen.
Chorus! If you want to know what China's gonna do, let's pay attention to the Shisanu. The Shisanu, the Shisanu.
So that's it.
That's it?
Yeah, now it's time to get ready for the 14th five-year plan.
What?
Yeah, the Shisu.
The Shisu what?
It proved to be a big hit about a year ago. And then the Chinese government started thinking, oh, this is a new way to propagandize, and then more attempts were made. And then this is the latest one, 四个全面.
一个内是电, 两个内是线, 三个内是面, 四个是全面.
唱啥呢?
听说过四个全面吗?
是中国梦啥的?
还是听我说吧。
听我说四个全面, 四个全面, 小康是目标。
小康是每个人的梦想，吃喝不愁，钱在心里就不慌。有了金山银山，还要绿水青山，生态环境健康发展，物来土以散。全面深化改革，不是随便说说，升学就业养老看病全都得有着落。人人都当创客，城乡一起嗨，舒服需要打破，体制必须活络。一个内是电，两个内是线，三个内是面，四个是全面。小康是目标，改革是动力，法治是保障，党建是关键。特别重要的话，咱得说四遍。四个四个四个四个四个四个全面，特别重要的话，咱得说四遍。 四个四个四个四个四个全面，法治是保障。我说四个全面，四个全面，法治是保障。全面依法治国，不想规矩不行，遵法守法用法有权不能任性，潜规则没用，凡事甭耍赖皮，法律面前都平等，拼捏你也没戏。全面从严治党，风清才能气爽，老虎关进笼里，苍蝇也得落网。党是核心领导，领着咱们奔跑，这样事儿的领路人咱都给他叫好。一个内是电。
两个内是线，三个内是面，四个是全面。小康是目标，改革是动力，法治是保障，党建是关键。特别重要的话，咱得说四遍。四个四个四个四个四个四个全面。特别重要的话，咱得说四遍。四个四个四个四个四个四个全面。跟我说四个全面，四个全面。小康是目标，跟我说四个全面，四个全面。改革是动力，跟我说四个全面。
走着。六六六六四个全面中国，九六六六六四个全面中国，九六六六六六四个全面中国，九六六六六四个全面中国，九六六六四个全面中国，九六六六四个全面中国，九六六六四个全面中国，九六六六四个全面中国，九六六六四个全面中国，九六六六四个全面中国，九六六六四个全面中国，九六六六四个全面中国，九六六六四个全面中国，九六六六四个全面中国，九六六六四个全面中国，九六六六四个全面中国，九六六六四个全面中国，九六六六四个全面中国，九六六六四个全面中国，九六六六四个全面中国，九六六六四个全面中国，九六六六四个全面中国，九六六六四个全面中国，九六六六四个全面中国，九六六六四个全面中国，九六六六四个全面中国，九六六六四个全面中国，九六六六四个全面中国，九六六六四个全面中国，九六六六四个全面中国，九六六六四个全面中国，九六六六四个全面中国，九六六六四个全面中国，九六六六四个全面中 very rich with science and different systems of science. It's multimedia, actually more than one medium. Let's return to our theme, intersemiotic translation. Of the four programs, there is some commonality. They all work towards target readers or listeners or audience of a different language. For example, the student content, Chen Wang Dao and Xin Da Ya, targets English readers and audience. 我的妈妈没有痴呆 targets Chinese audience. And 十三文四个全面 target foreign readers or listeners of non-Chinese. Another commonality is they are not text-based. They are not translating word for word, or they are not trying to produce equivalents of words in another language. Rather, they are conceptually led or based or guided. They all work on concepts. They all try to make or help target audience, readers, understand the concept rather than just some simple words or sentences. For example, the first one intends to explain Xin Da Ya and text-based translation to English audience. And the second one intends to show the problem with some existing translation, such as Alzheimer into 痴呆老年痴呆症. So it works toward, it concentrates on some concepts and trying to get some concepts across languages and cultures. And third one centers on 十三五, which is very Chinese, very modern Chinese, and very difficult to understand by foreigners. And the fourth one, 四个前面, has to do with the messages conveyed by the Chinese leadership. They're usually very erudite, very profound, very difficult to understand. So they try to carry this across cultural boundaries or language boundaries by other signs. But then we need to consider some ethical questions. Meaning, would you like to do any of this? Would you like to refrain from doing any of this? Which we'll revisit the ethic questions later, shortly. These are some of the things essential to intersemiotic translation. I've said some of these already. Firstly, it's conceptually guided and based. Secondly, it has an agenda, usually an activist agenda, and sometimes a reactivist or reactionary agenda, meaning it has a purpose. For example, Chen Wang Dao and Xin Da Ya, the video, has an agenda of helping target readers understand what Xin Da Ya is all about, what text-based translation is all about. It's also paving the basis, on the basis of which, it's also paving ground on the basis of which people can criticize it and develop a new approach of translation. Second one, 我的妈妈没有痴呆has an agenda of changing people's language behavior, changing people's language prejudice. If you say someone is 痴呆, we're giving a bad name to that person. So let's try to retranslate Alzheimer into something else. So that's the agenda. Shisanwu has an agenda too, helping everyone to understand Shisanga Wunyan Jihua, the 13th five-year plan, and making people accept it, maybe more, accept it more perhaps. And it has the agenda of propagandize the message of the party, the message of the president of the chairman of the Chinese Communist Party. So they all have an agenda. They all have a purpose. This is different from conventional translators, where translators are assumed to be neutral, or assumed to be a shadow, or assumed to be impartial. When we talk about translation, we usually name some ethics such as impartiality. You should not take sides. But here you can see an activist agenda of taking side, trying to help someone, trying to help a party, or trying to help a concept to get across. So it's people have an agenda now. Next. Intersemiotic translation embodies an enhanced awareness of target audience. People used to just translate without thinking of the audience. But now we're thinking of the audience. We're thinking, how can we make it more accessible to the audience? How we can make it more reader-friendly or audience-friendly, etc. And we have an enhanced awareness of the target medium or media that we use. We'll talk more about it shortly. And intersemiotic translation usually carries an anticipation of the desired outcome. We anticipate the outcome. What sort of objectives we would like to achieve. So we have a very clear anticipation, and we try to realize the anticipation. Also, intersemiotic translation often involves live translation, performance, animation, etc. It also involves multimedia expressions, and it involves the conversions or fusion or the mixture or blending together of a lot of media, a lot of expression, a lot of sign systems. For example, when you see 四个全面, you see not just animation, but you also see a flash, you also see subtitles, you also see embedded comments or the fake readers' comments. So they converge a lot of sign systems into one product. And also, there is a lot of duplication, there is some creativity, and the pace is ever faster. Can you think of others? Other things which are essential, which are common to those things. Yeah, think about it. As we don't have the luxury of time, I'll just continue. But I encourage people to think of other things essential to intersemiotic translation. Okay, this has to do with the understanding of the media now. So some of the options available include media. Now, if we use media, we can use video, we can use animation, we can use flash, we can use cartoons, for example, too. And some of the industry best practices are listed here. Animation is important. Multiple voices and visions are important. But some of them are fake multiple voices. For example, this one, there appear to be many voices, but they repeat the same thing. But sometimes you can see good programs. For example, this, the one, Mama, 我的妈妈没有痴呆, it has some truly multiple voices. But this one has fake multiple voices. My claim is, the more true multiple voices you have, the better. And they're not very long. Usually 3 to 4 minutes for animation, 4 to 6 minutes for lectures, presentations, etc. And anywhere between 4 or 5 and 10 minutes for little dramas or interviews. And genre, there is a lot of singing, hip hop, singing, dancing. There is also this. People use or imitate the style of stand-up comedy. People use some dramas. People use parodies. People use interviews, etc., etc. But there must be others that people can use. So if you use, if you do option B, please consider what technology options are available to you, what media options are available to you. Now, let's explore more possibilities. Let's use more examples to explore the possibilities. You must have heard Yan Fu, who's the father of Xin Da Ya. He claimed, he made many claims about Xin Da Ya, accurate, comprehensive, beautiful translation. But in practice, a lot of people think he's a butcher, because he butchered the original source language, and he reproduced his very creative translation, especially of evolution and ethics. He translated evolution and ethics into Chinese, very Chinese style of poetic-like verse. So I would call it inter-genre translation. Have you seen the movie by Jiang Wen, Let the Bullet Fly? That's a movie translation of a foreign book. Or have you seen the movie by Xu Jinglei, 一个陌生女人的来信? That's also a movie translation of a foreign book. And then there is also the English example, the Hollywood translation of Hua Mulan. There are three episodes or something, I think. Yeah. They reproduced the Chinese story into Hollywood style. And then there is Ansley and Bonnie's translation of plant-based translation into animated cartoons. I'll show you this. This was made by two students of 2012, maybe, wrote a story. I wrote up a paper called Plant-Based Translation. And they translated it into animation. They took about 1,700 pictures and compiled this.
With someone, a girl like that can get attention. I could just go walking her way. All I've got to do is figure out the words I need to say. Ooh, I just need an introduction. Coming up with nothing. Ooh, what do I
In my paper, I used the analogy of shoes. So they elaborated, they created a piece of work by using the shoes and the choice of shoes as the theme.中文有一个叫失足靴啊，靴足失履，靴足失履。You cut your shoe, you cut your feet to fit the size of the shoes. You know, that's not a good situation for assessment. The best assessment is you buy the best shoes for each pair of feet. So they re-illustrated this through a story.Animation. Let me take you down, 'cause I'm going to strawberry fields. Nothing is real, nothing to get hung about. Strawberry fields forever.You know, I know when it's a dream. I think you know, I mean a yes, but it's all wrong. That is, I think I disagree. Let me take you down, 'cause I'm going to strawberry fields.
Tuesday, I'm looking tired and feeling quite sick. I felt like there was something missing in my day-to-day life. So I quickly opened the wardrobe, pulled out some jeans and a t-shirt that seemed clean. Topped it off with a pair of old shoes that were ripped around the seams. And I thought these shoes just don't suit me. Hey, I put some new shoes on.
是形影不离，两个人的悄悄话，一辈子说不烦，听不腻。仰头看你微笑眯起眼睛，温柔的好像爱情的诗句，你无条件包容我被疼爱的感觉，很快乐。我非常爱你，非常确定，你像亲人又像知己，多么幸运能遇见你，是上天赐给我的福气。那种开心，那种窝心，那种安心，幸福很难，我相信，只要我们够努力，沿途遥望望那也都是美景。
So that's another example. And then there is also the example of Yuan Tianpeng's live translation of Robert's Rules of Order. I'll talk about it in another lecture perhaps. We're running out of time, so we'll... Okay. Now it's time to come back and revisit the ethics. What sort of projects would you rather do? It's all about doing or carrying out the agenda, but what sort of agenda would you like to be part of? I'll just use myself as an example. What would I consider personally? Is it really? So when I do a project, I'll consider first, is it related to a what is seen as an activist or progressive cause? To me, my mother may or the mama may or today, it is activist. It is progressive because we are advocating equality. We are advocating the best interests of the underprivileged people, disabled people. Is 成王道信达雅 a worthy cause? Yes, it is. We are changing how translation is taught, how translation is conducted. So to me, it's also a worthy cause. Is 十三五 a good project? To me, mostly yes. Because it's a Chinese concept,It's a concept, it's a kind of situation related to China as a country, to how China runs, to how China operates. So I would still consider doing it. But 四个全面, would I do it? I hesitate, I refrain.Or maybe I would rather say I will not do it. Because why? Because it has to do with, it's related to power, to a party, to an authoritarian party, to one political organization. So it's too political, it's too authoritarian, and it is centered on one person, on the worship or idolatry.